The Velvet Underground's debut is a completely iconic record, but has also been talked about to death, rightfully so. I want to shift gears and focus on the band's follow-up album, the black sheep of the Velvet Underground's catalog, White Light, White Heat. Severing ties with both Warhol and Nico, the band released the most unwelcoming album possible, featuring wild songs about orgasms, methamphetamine, and botched lobotomies. But that's not even the tip of the iceberg. White Light, White Heat closes with the monolithic Sister Ray, a 17-minute long drug-fueled slab of pure debauchery, noisy enough to challenge even the most devoted of fans. They asked us what we were going to do, frontman Lou Reed said, recalling a conversation the band had with the studio's engineer before recording the iconic Sister Ray. We said, we're going to start. They said, who's playing bass? We said, there is no bass. They asked us when it ends. We didn't know. When it ends, that's when it ends. This video is an ode to Sister Ray, a minute-by-minute companion piece to one of the wildest songs ever released. Are you ready? Let's go. In just 17 minutes, Sister Ray develops from this cutthroat opening riff to complete chaos as Lou comes in cool with the vocals. There's already a whole lot to unpack here. What purposefully sounds like he's saying something else, Lou Reed's opening salvo, Duck and Sally Inside, introduces two of the eight characters mentioned in the song. And what are these eight characters up to? I'll quote frontman Lou Reed here again, coming in with one of the weirder sentences you'll hear today. The situation is a bunch of drag queens taking some sailors home with them, shooting up on smack and having this orgy when the police appear. Here, the term sailor is used literally, referring to New York's status as a bustling port city and all of the varied faces that pass through as a result, which populate many Velvet Underground songs. And as much as Reed's vocals paint this sleazy scene, the track's instrumental plays equal parts, John Cale entering on a supercharged Vox Continental organ. The refrain, just like Sister Ray said, hints at the title character being a kind of ringleader or dominant figure in this scene that Reed is describing. The frontman took inspiration from the streets of New York to help flesh out the track. Sister Ray was this black queen, Reed described. John and I were uptown, out on the street, and up comes this person, very nice, but flaming. Duck, Sally, Miss Rayon, the sailor, and all of the other people mentioned in the track enter and exit in a kind of stream of consciousness, as Sister Ray has a loose lyrical narrative, but Reed lets the listener fill in the gaps. Back to the track, our seafaring friend gets caught in a jam as newcomer Cecil whips out his new piece. Despite the chaos, the characters comically worry more about the state of their carpet than the semen freshly gracing their floor. Reed also seems a little too preoccupied to care. It's probably no surprise that Sister Ray was one of Andy Warhol's favorite Velvet Underground tracks, as Reed reflected in 1989, just 2 years after Warhol's death. When we were making the second record, Warhol said, "Now you gotta make sure that you do the sucking on my ding dong song." He was a lot of fun. He really was, Reed said. But the frontman is also quick to defend the album's wordplay. "The lyrics aren't negative," Reed said. "White light, white heat, it has to do with methamphetamine. Sister Ray is all about that. But they are telling you stories and feelings. They are not stupid." These feelings come out just as much in the song's instrumentation as they do in the lyrics. "There is a musical struggle," guitarist Sterling Morrison said. "Everyone's trying to do what he wants to do every second, and nobody's backing off." Tired of arguing about which takes to use of certain songs during the recording of White Light, White Heat, the Velvets agreed to record one unedited version of the album's finale, done live in the studio. On Sister Ray, which we knew was going to be a major effort, we stared at each other and said, "This is going to be one take, so whatever you want to do, you better do it now." The improvisational nature of the song quickly escalated into a competition to see who could play the loudest. Morrison recalls, "When Cale came surging through the wall of sound on his first solo, I remember thinking, where's John getting all that noise from? I see him fumbling over there with all the stops on his organ. And all of a sudden, the organ is way louder than me and Lou. I couldn't turn up, I was already maxed out." And while Reed, Cale, and Morrison could play with their setups on the fly to achieve a louder output, drummer Maureen Tucker's efforts can't go unnoticed, holding the track down for the whole 17-minute marathon, pounding away as the room fills with feedback. As the jam continues to evolve, Reed comes back in with another verse, spitting out a reference to Edgar Allan Poe's The Raven, as the police come not so gently rapping at the chamber door. As you can hear, Sister Ray starts to get a little off the rails here, each band member playing harder and faster to outdo everyone else in the room. We were intent on recording this album live in the studio because we were so good live at that point, Cale said. To keep that animalism there, we insisted on playing at the volume that we played on stage. We were working in a very small studio with no isolation, so it was all this noise just smashing into more noise. As Morrison continued, Gary Kellgren, the engineer who is ultra competent, told us repeatedly, "You can't do it, all the needles are on red." And we reacted as we always reacted, "Look, we don't know what goes on in there and we don't want to hear about it. Just do the best you can," Morrison recalled. According to Reed, White Light, White Heat's 17-minute closer was what pushed the recording engineer to his breaking point. "When we recorded Sister Ray, the engineer stood up and said, 'Listen, I'm leaving. You can't pay me enough to listen to this crap. I'll be down in the commissary getting coffee. When you're done, hit that button and come get me. Halfway through the track, Reed cuts back into the song's opening line, this time a little more frantic with the verse. Morrison hinted at how the lyrical themes and wild nature of Sister Ray reflected the state of the band at that point. Our lives were chaos, Morrison recalled. Things were insane, day in and day out. The people we knew, the excesses of all sorts. For a long time, we were living in various places, afraid of the police, Morrison added. At the height of my musical career, I had no permanent address. But the studio cut of Sister Ray isn't complete anarchy, as the Velvets regroup towards the 10-minute mark, bringing the track to a slow crawl. Here, Reed continues to repeat verses from earlier in the song, switching to a calmer delivery this time. Now Rosie has a play on. They're busy waiting for her booster. This point of the song really demonstrates what makes Sister Ray work. Sure, the track is fierce, noisy, and experimental, but at no point is it ever aimless. Remember, the track was recorded live, with no cuts or splices. Here, the Velvets are able to seamlessly bring the chaotic jam back to its main groove, slowing things down and showing that they're in control of this beast called Sister Ray. This 17-minute long studio take is also fairly short compared to some live versions of the song. During a 1969 show at the Matrix in San Francisco, the Velvets jammed Sister Ray for a whopping 36 minutes, bending the cut from a soft groove to harsh noise and everything in between. The band were known for never playing a song the same way twice, and Sister Ray was really no exception, with each live performance turning into a wildly different improvisation of the track. "We'd start way off," Cale said, "with something totally chaotic and gradually work our way back to the version on the record. Very long, very intense, with Lou becoming a southern preacher man, telling stories and just inventing these fantastic characters as we played." When Reed was asked why Sister Ray was often done as a finale to the band's live sets, he answered, "You don't want to follow it with anything. Mainly, the instruments are wrecked by the time we finish." Reed wasn't exaggerating here. Back to the studio version of Sister Ray, Cale's organ starts to really sound like it's been through hell and back, emitting a distorted electronic pitch. As you may have guessed, the slower, rhythmic break in the middle of the song doesn't last long, as the Velvets speed the track up for a bombastic, explosive finale. Over the next handful of minutes, the band will progress into one of the noisiest studio recordings of the 1960s, a true assault on anyone fanatic enough to dig this deep into the band's sophomore album. And despite the absurdity of Sister Ray and White Light, White Heat as a whole, many argue that this era of the band's sound is a highlight. "That's the litmus test," Morrison said. "If you like that album, then you like the Velvet Underground." Infamous rock critic Lester Bangs also argued that White Light, White Heat separated true fans of the band from posers who just bought their records because it was cool. None of these name-dropping assholes actually sit around listening to Sister Ray for fucking pleasure, ever, Bangs wrote in 1981. Unsurprisingly, White Light, White Heat was not the most popular album of 1968. The record barely slid into the US Billboard Top 200, peaking at number 199. Still, some contemporary reviews spoke favorably of the chaotic release, one of the best lines coming from a May 1968 issue of the LA Free Press. Listening is like a visit to hell without getting burned, and we'd all like that, wouldn't we? We were doing the whole heavy metal trip back then, Morrison said. If Sister Ray isn't an example of heavy metal, I don't know what is. Sister Ray's influence on loud music is undeniable, Reed dubbing White Light, White Heat as the quintessence of articulated punk. UK punk legends The Buzzcocks formed in 1976 after one of their members posted an ad looking for other musicians who liked Sister Ray. As Sister Ray peaks, Tucker pounding away trying to keep everyone in time, Cale shrieking away with his organ on its last legs, and Reed and Morrison assaulting the room with feedback-drenched guitar attacks, the foursome miraculously managed to bring the track together again at the 16-minute mark. And as harshly as the track began with that grinding opening riff 17 minutes earlier, Reed repeats the song's first verse as the Velvet Underground close one of the wildest sonic rides put to tape. But how the hell do you close a track as off the walls as Sister Ray? Well, you sputter out something like this. Yes, Reed's last line in the song is just him saying the word amphetamine. The track is truly unique in its own right, sounding like nothing else released in 1968. And even half a century later, with how influential the Velvet Underground are on modern music, and the endless amount of songs at our disposal today, there's still nothing quite like it. And that's what makes Sister Ray truly a special thing. Thanks for tuning in.